Good morning. Come on, y'all knew better than that. Good morning. Woo, that was pretty strong. Great. It's good to see you. I missed you. Have y'all missed each other? Yeah, last week it snowed. That was kind of crazy, wasn't it? Look at the difference between the two weekends. Hello. Only in the South. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, it's 70 degrees yesterday, and then last week, this time, it didn't even get out of freezing, I think. It was like 32 degrees all day, something like that. And wow, so here we are. And so it's good to have you. The week before, a buddy of mine, New Year's Day, Stephen Talbert, he brought the message that day, did an incredible job. I watched y'all online. Y'all don't think I was, but see, I said, take the camera, turn it around, I want to see who's there. And I'm just kidding, didn't do that. But thank you. I love y'all. And I don't know if you feel this. I hope you do. You know, even if you're a visitor, I hope you kind of feel when you walk through the doors here, it's like you're at home. Is it, you know, you just, oh, this is so, because I think that's what church is supposed to be. And I think that maybe for too many years it got to be this thing where it's kind of big, something, and we became organized and we became religious. Maybe I'm being too harsh. Maybe I just can't quite put my finger on it. Maybe that's what I'm struggling for. And I know that one of the things that I longed for when I was at a church, one of the things that I longed for was I wanted to be a part of something and to feel at home and to feel loved and to feel that God loved me, but that maybe somebody down here on earth did too and that they cared. And I do hope that's what you feel when you walk through the doors of this church, because we work really, really hard. That's our goal. Our goals are different than a lot of folks might think, and we want to reach every single person we can that doesn't know Jesus, but that when they walk through the doors of this church, one of the ways that I think that they'll be blown away by the love of God is through us taking just a minute to love on them as well. I hope you felt that. What am I talking about today, y'all know? Oh, yeah. Also, we weren't here last week, and so we didn't take up an offering. I just wanted to see what your reaction might be. Oh, no, he's going to give us the speech. No, just, you know, and I don't remember what the offering was. A lot of you were faithful and you gave online, but just to remind you that we would really appreciate it if you would consider making up for the week that you missed if you didn't do that. Is that okay? Can I say that? We're family, right? We're family. Yeah, absolutely. So let me ask this question. How many of you started off the New Year's with a few resolutions? Anybody started with maybe just a few resolutions? I read that vitamin shops, the biggest business of the year is in the month of January. Health club memberships, you know, go up in the month of January. The funny thing is, and I've been told this because I was really close to a guy that owns a gym, he said, actually, one of the funny things about January is there are people that have been members all year long. They just come the month of January. Yeah, absolutely. Sporting goods stores are selling out of, you know, apparel, workout apparel out the wazoo. You know, everybody's going on a diet to lose some of those holiday pounds. And if you haven't gone on a diet to lose some of those holiday pounds, I saw some of you when you walked in, you need to. I'm just saying. Don't throw rocks. But here's the crazy thing about resolutions. The crazy thing about resolutions is usually by February, most resolutions are forgotten and they're gone. And life gets back to normal. And when I say normal being defined as life before resolutions, right? Yeah. And I don't think that resolutions are a bad thing. In fact, I think resolutions are a good thing. I think it is good, you know, that we have at least some point in the year, most of the time that is the New Year's, you know, where we sit down, we start to look at, you know, how we've been eating, and we're thinking, man, I didn't really blew it during the holidays. But some of us would say, you know what, I wish I could blame my weight gain on Christmas, but it wasn't just Christmas. And some of us will go back to Thanksgiving, and it will be between Thanksgiving and Christmas. And then some of us will say, who am I kidding? I didn't eat good all last year, you know. And so it's good to kind of sit down and say, you know, maybe this year it's time to maybe do some things about that. It's a great time to look at your finances and to say, you know what, we struggled last year. This year is going to be different, and kind of look at, you know, the input and the output, and kind of to see, you know, where you stand financially. Those are some really, really, really good questions. But I think that the basic question that we end up asking with resolutions is this: how do I make a better version of me? And that's not necessarily a bad thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing. But for the next few weeks, for the next 3 weeks, what I want to try to do is I want to try to push us a little bit. Okay, I'm going to push us a whole lot. I want us to think bigger and broader. There's another question that I think that we probably could process that honestly would not just make us better, not just make us faster, not just make a sweeter version of who we are, but I think that would change the world around us. And introduce the question that I want us to look at. I want us to look at an Old Testament guy. I love this guy. Old Testament guy by the name of Nehemiah. Nehemiah was the shortest man in the Bible. Nehemiah. I love it because we read so many unchurched people because you never heard that before. All the church people going, oh, man, that's lame. But, you know, for those of you that probably don't hang around church, some of y'all still aren't really getting the whole thing, but Nehemiah. So anyway, Nehemiah says, last verse, last part of chapter 1, he says that he was a cupbearer to the king. Now, actually, I had another week to kind of study through this message, and I really got kind of curious. I thought, I want to go back and kind of dig a little bit. What exactly does it mean to be a cupbearer to the king? Well, according to the New Bible Dictionary, cupbearers were often called pure of hands. Pure of hands. And in one instance, the one who tastes the wine. So really, the cupbearer was a glorified guinea pig for any beverage served to the king. His job was to guard against the king being poisoned. Because back in the day, one of the ways that an assassination would take place, a plot to kill the king might take place, would be to poison the wine. And so they had this guy, he was a cupbearer, and his primary responsibility was to taste whatever beverage that the king might partake of to make sure that it wasn't poisoned. So in other words, if he lived, then the king thought, okay, it's okay then to, you know, to drink this beverage. And I read that, this was interesting, I read that Nehemiah was a high official in the Persian court. A high official in the Persian court. But the interesting thing is that nowhere in any of the things that I read and studied that it said to be a cupbearer meant that he was a great leader. And yet, if you've been around church for a while, one of the things that you know is that leadership talks that are done in the Christian circle will all often go back to the book of Nehemiah. And we'll talk about Nehemiah and this incredible leader and this extraordinary man. But when it comes down to it, when you look at really who he was in this context, he was just a guy that tasted the king's wine. That's really who he was. Doesn't say anything about that he was a great leader, that he had great leadership potential. In fact, you know what the cool thing about the book of Nehemiah for me is that maybe Nehemiah is no different than a lot of us, you know? That when people would look at us, they don't see any great potential. They don't see that you're a great leader, that there's anything that you might actually accomplish for the kingdom of God. But that God would look at you and there's something special about who you are. And I think that's one of the neat things about this story. It just meant that he was trustworthy, that he was humble, that he was brave. And so for this reason, cupbearers were often among the king's most trusted servants. Now, one of the reasons I also think this is such a fascinating story is that there are no miracles in this story. Now, some of you probably would want to raise your hand right now if you've been in church for very long, if you've read the book of Nehemiah, if you've studied the book of Nehemiah, you'd probably want to raise your hands. Oh, well, yeah, this was a miracle. Well, when I say miracle, I'm talking about there wasn't anybody healed. Nobody was healed. Nobody gets raised from the dead. I mean, there's no water turned to wine. There's no big miracle in the book of Nehemiah when you look at it. Nobody walks on water in the book of Nehemiah. The story of Nehemiah is really about a story, and this is so much more important than you can possibly imagine. It's a story about a heavy burden. That's where it starts. It doesn't start with a great leader. It starts with a normal guy, an average guy who was a cupbearer to the king. He was honest. He was trustworthy. And so he was put in this position because of that. But he wasn't put in the position because he was a great leader. This was a guy that had a great burden. That's where the story starts. So it's a story about a heavy burden and hard work, and it is a story about leadership. And so if you're interested in leadership, then I would just encourage you to go to the book of Nehemiah because there's some great leadership lessons to be learned. And it's a really, really powerful story that I think sets up the better question for us to ask, the broader question. To go beyond just a resolution to say, how can I make a better, faster, sweeter version of me? It's a bigger question than that. And I think that we'll see that, hopefully, by the time that we get to the end of the first chapter. Let me set up the story a little bit more so you understand what's going on. The story takes place right after what's been called the Jewish exile. Now, for those of you that hadn't been in church, for those of you that don't even really care, let me give you a little bit of history because I think this is super important that you understand. In 605 B.C., the Babylonians invade Judah. The Babylonians invade Judah, and if you think of modern-day Israel, if you think of Israel as the top half and the bottom half, and the top half would be the northern kingdom, and the bottom half would be the southern kingdom, and the southern kingdom is also often referred to as Judah. Now, so those of you that are trying to, I've read the Bible a couple times. If you're trying to kind of get your bearings a little bit, the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, hello, maybe you've heard kind of that story. Even if you've not been in church, you've probably heard it's kind of a wild story. Or maybe Daniel in the lion's den, have you heard that story? Well, this is that same time period when they were taken from Jerusalem and taken to work for Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. And so for about 70 years, the nation of Israel, they're basically shut down. They kind of went out of business. And so they're conquered by the Babylonians. So about 70 years go by, and then the Persians invade the Babylonians. And so Cyrus the Great, he looks around and he says, we got a lot of Jews that look like they're kind of misplaced and they're scattered. So he says, why, you know, what happened? And so he makes a decree. He says, okay, so if you're one of those Jewish folks and you were taken into captivity, I just want you to go home. Wherever your home might be, I just want you to go back home. And so it's a sweet part of the story where these guys have the opportunity to go back, to migrate back to their homeland. But actually, things didn't go all so well. So about 90 years later is when we meet Nehemiah. So have you been following the story? Now, this is really super important because if you don't know this part, I think there's a huge part of this story that's missing. And honestly, for me, for a lot of years, this was a part that I missed. Here's what you need to know. He was a Jewish man, but as far as we know, he's never been to Judah. Doesn't mean a whole lot right now, but it will in a few minutes. As far as we know, he's never been to Jerusalem. As far as we know, he's never worshipped in the temple. He has the background. That's his heritage. As far as we know, he's never been there. When we meet Nehemiah, he is working for King Artaxerxes of Persia. So it sounds like a pretty sweet gig so far, right? You already know, I've already given you that little insight that he's a cupbearer to the king. And so Nehemiah is in Persia, he's working for the king, and then he begins to journal this story, this pilgrimage, this journey, this adventure that he went on. And it's called the Book of Nehemiah, and it's a book in the Old Testament. The Jews thought that this was a beautiful story, and so they treasured the story and they kept it in their scriptures. So let's jump in and look at chapter 1 and see if by the end, if we might be able to ask a bigger, broader question. So here's how it goes. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakalai, in the month of Kishlu, in the 20th year, while I was at the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah. Remember, that's the southern part of Israel, with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile, and also about Jerusalem. Now remember, these people were migrating back to their home, right? They had been in captivity. Now, why were they in captivity? Well, we'll kind of get into that in a minute. But there was this conditional contract, this conditional covenant that God had with his people. And often what would happen, and it happens to us, is if God's kids, God's chosen, would look around and they would see another people and they would think, you know what, it looks like their God's a lot cooler than our God. They don't have as many rules. They don't have as many regulations. It looks like a kind of sweet deal is going on. And so really, when you study the Old Testament, and this is, I was talking to somebody earlier this morning, this is kind of the thing for me was, I look at the God of the Old Testament as being, I was taught that he was different than the God of the New Testament. That's what I was taught. I was taught that the God of the Old Testament was mean and nasty and violent. The God of the New Testament is all about grace and mercy. Actually, when you look at the Old Testament and you begin to look at it through the lens of even the New Testament and of Jesus, I think what you see is something that's a little bit different. And so they were conquered by the Babylonians because I think that what God said was, you know what, if that's what you want, then I'm just going to take my hands off of you. And so they suffered the consequences. And so now they're able to go back home. And so Nehemiah, who's never been there, says, well, how is that going? And I wonder if this is like Christian ease. When I read that, just if you're in the beginning, don't think that you know the rest of the story, for those of you that know the story. It's just like one of those sweet things. Maybe it's just a Southern thing. You know, where we look at people and say, how are you doing? We don't care. We really don't. We don't care. It's just the sweet thing that we Southern people do. How's your family? God bless you. How are the kids? And then, you know, people will start to tell you that stuff. And you can almost watch Southern people back up and go, whoa, you ain't from here, are you? And I just wonder, is this like just the sweet thing to say, the godly thing to say? Hey, I heard you guys were migrating back. Tell me, how is that going? I wonder if he really cares. Well, let's read on. They said to me, those who survived the exile or back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire, which basically means we have no defense. And as God's people, that we have no defense, we're a disgrace to God. Things aren't going well. And then Nehemiah makes this statement. When I heard these things, he said, I sat down and wept. And honestly, when you read that, you think, that sounds a little strange. Now, it sounds a little strange because he's going to weep over the condition of a city that he's never been. He's broken over something that he's never seen. In other words, Nehemiah wasn't just about the Christian ease. He wasn't just, oh, yeah, sorry. Good luck. Hope things work out for you. Hey, gee, I'll put you on the prayer list down at the church. We got a prayer team. I'll have the prayer team praying for you. But honestly, I live in the king's palace. Man, I live and eat and breathe indoors. You know what I'm talking about? I am tasting the king's wine. That's a pretty sweet gig right there. You know, my family and I are living the life, man. I have daily contact with the most powerful person in the world. Hate that about Jerusalem, you know. See you, wouldn't want to be you. He sat down and he wept. And he goes on, for some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And so if you're just kind of processing this, with no evidence that I know of, and I dug as hard and studied as hard as I could to find out, had Nehemiah actually ever been there 150 years later? Has Nehemiah actually ever visited the city? Had he ever seen it for himself? And as best I can find, the answer to that question would be no. And so when you look at this, you think, you know what? This is a burden that has to come from God. It has to be God-driven. God-given. Because why in the world would somebody have a burden over something that they've never seen? And I made this note just this morning because I think that in the church world, over the last 15, 20 years, there's been a lot of talk about vision. And over the years, I've talked to a lot of young guys who are starting churches, and they want to come, they want to sit down, and they want to talk to me about their vision. And let me just be honest, they had great vision. I would talk to some of those guys that could deliver that vision with clarity. I remember sitting down with the guy who brought his laptop, have mercy. This guy was a brainiac if there ever been one. Turned that sucker around. He was able to hit button after button after button. He had demographical studies. He had done everything that you could possibly think of to be able to get his vision, to make it concise, to make it compelling. But I learned that at the end of the day, after a few weeks, the thing that he lacked was not vision. It was a burden. And see, what I think is that sometimes we get so caught up in being visionary, and oftentimes what I see in today's church world is that somebody just borrowed somebody else's vision. And here's what I know. If you borrow somebody else's vision, then one day it won't be enough for you. Because life is hard. Ministry's hard. But when you get up every day and what what propels you through your day is because you have a burden that you can't get rid of. You love people and you can't help it. You with me? Is anything like that ever happened to you? I mean, has God begun to stir your heart? Have you ever just woke up in the middle of the night over something and you thought, what in the world's wrong with me? What did we drink last night? What did my wife put something in the tea? I mean, what? Have mercy. I mean, what's going on? And then maybe, have you ever just caught yourself maybe at different times during the day, caught yourself maybe in kind of a haze and you kind of just drifted off for a little bit and you find yourself thinking about things that really don't make any sense to you at all? They're about situations that you can't even imagine. When you look at yourself, you think, I am just a simple man. I'm just a simple woman. Why in the world? But maybe what that is that God is beginning to stir and to do a work in you about something that he wants you to do. And you can't connect the dots because you think with your spiritual gifts, there's no way that you could make it happen. Well, then you need to read the book of Nehemiah, I'm just saying. So then he journals this prayer that he prays for his nation. And again, probably a nation probably that he's never even been to. I mean, as I'm processing this, I'm thinking, I know it's a rich heritage, and I can't wrap my brain around this Jewish heritage, and I know some sweet Jewish people, and talking to them, I think, oh my gosh, you go back, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of years that you are connected, and I get that. I do, I get that. This is deep. So he journals this prayer that he's going to pray, and here's what he said. He said, then I said, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant. And he wasn't playing, man, when he used the right word. Are you with me? He used the word covenant. And covenant is different than a contract. A contract is when we have a contract, and so if you live up to your end and I live up to my end, and then we're in a contract together. But if you blow your end, I'm not liable for my end. And if I blow it on my end, then you can get out of the contract because there was a contract. But this is a covenant, and what a covenant is a covenant says, listen, I want you to understand, here are the conditions I'm in regardless of what you do. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter how you fail. And so this was a covenant. Listen to what he says. Who keeps his covenant of love. What? That's bigger than you think. It's bigger than you think of this covenant of love. In other words, God looks at his people and he says, you know what? I love you so much that I'm going to make a covenant with you. No matter what you do, no matter how many times you walk away from me, no matter how many times, you know what, you get snowed by some other god, some other religion, and you're drawn into another group of people because you think that their way is better than my way, no matter how many times you do that, I'm going to make a covenant with you that I will never stop loving you. Come on now, that ought to get somebody to say amen or something. Yeah, isn't that sweet? It was sweet to me. Who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. In the Old Testament, God had set up this relationship. And I understand this, and I still struggle with it. It's a relationship. It's a conditional relationship. Here are my laws. If you keep my laws and you follow me, and if you obey me, you get to live in your land. But if you don't follow my laws and you abandon me, then I'm going to take away your land, and I'm going to send you to the uttermost parts of the earth. And I get that. I get that. I do. And I know what that says. But as I continue to look at the Old Testament, I always get this idea that it's God just saying, you know what, if that's what you want, if that's the life that you want to live, I just want you to know, I'm just going to back away and let you live it. And then you'll just suffer the consequences. Because there's privileges to being one of my kids. He goes on, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. And then he does something really interesting. He says this, I just think this is so cool. He says, I confess the sins, we Israelites. This sounds like a professional prayer to me, doesn't it, you? Doesn't it? I mean, it kind of sounds like a professional prayer, like it's a professional pastor, and so he's going to get up and he's going to, on behalf of our people, oh God, I come before you today. Sounds like that's kind of like what it is. But he doesn't stop there, including myself. See, that was a game changer for me. I went, oh my gosh, wait a minute. He wasn't just saying, look, truth of it is, you know, don't you think it would have been tempting? Because, I mean, that's the way self-righteous people do. And I've been in church long enough that I've seen enough church people, and I've listened to church people pray, and God, those people, you know what I'm saying? I mean, those people really screwed things up. But he said, God, you know, I'm guilty too. And my father's family have committed sin against you. We've acted very wickedly towards you, and we've not obeyed the commands and decrees and the laws you gave your servant Moses. And so he's saying, you know what, we're guilty. Bottom line, guilty. You know what, if you want to find healing in your life, then just confess what you're guilty of. Are you with me? And that's what we know when healing is starting to take place in somebody's life, is because those people aren't blaming everybody else anymore. Well, you know, I mean, I wouldn't be in the mess I'm in right now. I mean, my family, my mama, if it hadn't been for my mama, I wouldn't be as screwed up as I am today. Listen, you can't blame your mama forever. Are you with me? There's got to be a time when we grow up and say, you know what, I got to own my stuff. And that's what he does here. He says, we're guilty. I'm guilty. We deserve what we got. They didn't like you, didn't tell us. Saying we're guilty. And then he says, and I like this part too, he says, now remember, like God would forget. So he's going to set up, he's going to remind God of his own words, is what he's going to do. He says, but remember, oh Lord, remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you're unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. And that's exactly what happened. And again, this is just where I'm still working out my stuff. You work out your stuff. I'll work out my stuff. I'm just going to be honest as I'm working out my stuff. So is it like that he just scattered them? He says, you know, I'm just going to give you what you want. You think it's a better thing over here? I'm okay. But, and this is where the covenant of love comes in. But if you return to me, check this out, and obey my commands, even if you are exiled, your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people whom you redeemed. y'all don't see the humor in that at all. He's reminding God. He said, listen, man, these are your people. You love these people because you had a covenant of love. And you made a covenant of love because you really do love these people. You love us. I don't understand why you love us. We're guilty of sin. He's already been on it. We're guilty. We sinned against you. We didn't follow your commands. We completely abandoned you. But you redeemed us by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant, to the prayer of your servants who delight and revering your name. Give your servant success today. This is bigger than you think. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. So let me tell you what he's about to do. Nehemiah, who's got it made. Nehemiah, who's living the dream. Nehemiah, who's living in the palace. Who eats, lives, breathes, sleeps indoors. He's in daily contact with the most powerful man in the universe, King Artaxerxes. He's going to go before King Artaxerxes, and here's what he's going to say. He's going to say, by the way, I need like an indefinite leave of absence. Because I don't know how long this is going to take. And I know I got a cushy job. I know things are really good. And I want to go to Jerusalem, a place I've never been. And I want to help my people. I don't even know these people, just to be honest. I mean, we got a heritage, and we're Jewish, and that draws us together. But honestly, I don't know who they are. I never met these people before in my life. I'm going to help my people rebuild their city, and we're going to reestablish their presence in this land. And you didn't do that. You didn't go to the king and ask for favors. The king did all the asking. You didn't go to him and ask him for anything. It was risky. And he was sad. He was sad because he's already told us that he wept. He heard the news of the city, he heard that the walls were in ruin, and he wept, and he fasted, and he mourned, and he prayed. This is a broken man. You did not go before the king being sad. H.G. M. Williamson, in his Word Biblical Commentary, adds that a gloomy face would have been interpreted as plotting against the king. And if you went before the king with a sad countenance, he could take you out. And it was not only risky, it's a huge sacrifice. But his heart's broken. We're back to that stupid burden thing again. He didn't even know why. It couldn't be anything that he constructed on his own. It couldn't be that he just saw there was that commercial, you know, and they showed the kids there in Jerusalem, and oh my gosh, I mean, you know, their bellies were big and they were skinny. This wasn't that deal. He has this burden, and because he has this burden, he is willing to put it all on the line. I just think this is crazy kinds of stuff. This is a revolution that's going to take place of a man who was, that's the way he ends. He said, I don't even know what that means. I tried to dig into that too. You know, I thought there's got to be somebody with an idea. He ends this chapter, I was cupbearer to the king. I wonder if that's like he's looking back. I was. y'all, you with me? I mean, I'm wondering, like, he's not even out of the gate yet. You know, I used to be looking back on my life. I had it made. I was cupbearer to the king, but I ain't no more. I wonder if it was that kind of thing. I don't know. Y'all study and maybe you can find the answers. So here's the better question. What breaks your heart? When you look around at your community and your neighborhood and your city, when you look around the country that we live in, our country, when you look around at the economy and the school system and what's happening in families and what's happening with children, I'm just asking you, what breaks your heart? It's a dangerous question. It's the kind of question that gets us out of the comfort zone. And there's a lot of stuff that we could look around and see. I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but there's all kind of stuff. Do you watch TV at all? Do you watch CNN? Have mercy. Don't do it first thing in the morning. It'll just make you nauseous. I mean, all the news, and it just seems to be one bad thing after the other. And have you noticed that the news just seems to be filled with hate? And it seems like trying to bring us together, they're just trying to accentuate the negative. Maybe instead of going through this year asking the question that most people ask, how do I make a better, sweeter, faster version of me? What if we looked around in our world, our community? What if we looked at our neighbors? What if we looked at the woman at work? The guy at school. That guy in the gym. How about the checkout lady at Bilo? What if we just looked around and what if we just asked the question, how do I make the world a better place for you? What if we asked that question? If you're a Jesus follower, I just mean that by that, to the best of your ability, you're just trying to follow the ways of Jesus. You're trying to live like he lived and walk like he walked and talk like he talked. And if you are, then you must be actively involved. Man, that's a big statement. I'm telling you, I've had several weeks to look back over and to try to change it, but I've never changed it. You must be actively involved at some level. You must be, not you should be. Gee, it would be sweet if you would be. You must be actively involved at some level in your life, at some place in our culture, bringing about change. Well, listen to me, because people who follow Jesus, we make things better for other people. We just do. Listen. You can be religious and you can come to church. And we would be better off if we would just settle for that. If we would just not push you so much and We just make everybody feel good every Sunday and laugh a little bit and go home, you know, and say, come back next week and bring some of your friends and we'd laugh a little bit more. But I'm telling you, you can't actively follow Jesus and not make somebody else's life better. You can't. It's impossible. Because one of the things that Jesus taught is that devotion to God is measured in terms of our devotion to others. Our love for God is equated to our love for others. Just read the book. And so, consequently, when you follow Jesus through the Gospels, everywhere that Jesus went, he made people's lives better. People got healed. Dead people got raised from the dead. All that, that's sweet. Guilty people were forgiven of their sins. Man, people that would have thought, I have no hope for God. God wouldn't love somebody like me. And then Jesus comes on the scene and he looks and things happened and they felt loved. Jesus taught that all people have inherent value. All people matter to God. This is huge. Because this is what this church stands for. And this is what we will continue to stand for. In other words, Jesus modeled that there's not a pecking order. In Jesus' day, it would have been, I'm Roman. Gee, I hate you're not. Sorry. In the religious world that Jesus grew up in, it would have been a group of people that would have said, we're God's chosen. He loves us, not so much for you. That's the system that he grew up in. And Jesus came along and he said, you know what? It's not the color of your skin. It doesn't matter how much money you have. In the religious system that Jesus showed up in the religious system, do you realize that if you had money, they thought that it was because God loved you more? The truth, just check it out for yourself. They thought, see, you're probably more righteous. See, then that's why religion is, you know, puffs us up because we feel like we're doing such a good job that we deserve more from God. That's why people get angry at God. You go, how could you do this to me? Right? Because we think we deserve something. And so that was kind of the religious system that Jesus grew up in, where people, if they had more, it's because God loved them more and because they were better, and then God blessed them, and God blessed them because they were better. You understand where we're going with that? And then Jesus came along, and the way he conducted his ministry, he just loved people. He loved tax collectors and prostitutes, and dare I say it, at 9 o'clock service, he loved whores. So he loved those people. He loved lepers, and the people that everybody else walked away from, Jesus walked up to. It's crazy. So I'm just saying that to be like Jesus, there just can't be a first class and a second class. There can't be a pecking order. There's just people for whom Christ died. That's it. And this should make you proud. So consequently, through generations of Christendom, men and women in the name of Jesus built hospitals. Not for sick Christians. For sick people. They built orphanages. Not for Christian children. For abandoned children. They built shelters. Not for homeless Christians. You know, we've been challenged here. I've been challenged from time to time. Do we have a requirement? We're a part of a program and we physically house homeless people here for 1 week from Sunday to Sunday. And I've had people challenge me, or, well, they're all Christians, aren't they? No. I think they're on the crazy end of it. They can show up and be at a church for a week. I mean, how funny is that? You know what I'm saying? And so you would think, oh, so you're in there every night, like hitting them over the head with the gospel. Yes, we are. We're loving them. We're feeding them. We're showing them what the gospel looks like when we live it out. So, got to wrap this puppy up. I guess you could start off your New Year's by making some cool resolutions. And you could ask yourself, how can I make me a better version of me? Or you could look at Nehemiah and you could say, God, burden me. Don't start with a vision. Don't do that. Don't go read some cool book and hear some cool story. But don't attach yourself to somebody else's vision that way. Just say, God, what do you want to do with me? And you know what? God, you would walk into work tomorrow, and there'll be that lady, that man, and God will say, you know what? You're there. You just want to make life better for that person. Do you understand? That's our dream for 25 days of Christmas. Do you understand that we're just out there giving away money? Why? Because we just want to give it away, and we want. It's not attached to Springwell. We don't want to talk about Springwell. What we want to do is build up the name of Jesus to say, this is just how God works. See, when Christians show up, life is just made better for other people. And we're not here selling you something. It's not about our church. It's about Jesus. So maybe you should just pray that prayer. Lord, how can I make the world a better place? Maybe you're not a follower of Jesus, and the reason that you're not is because you had some really, really bad information. You had no idea about the love of God. And not just the love of God for the world, but the love of God for you. You just didn't know. Maybe you heard about the Old Testament. Whew, man, life was cheap in the Old Testament. God would zap you in a skinny minute. You didn't hear about the covenant of love. That, you know what? Didn't just start with Jesus in the New Testament. It actually started in the Old Testament with a group of people who miserably failed God. I mean, miserably failed God. You should check them out. It'll make you feel better about yourself. I'm not kidding. You look at the life of King David and you think, ooh, he was a bad man. And then you look at some of these other people and you go, oh my gosh, they miserably failed. And then the covenant of love was God said, you know what? But no matter what you do, you can't outrun my love. Because it's not contractual. It's not based on what you do or how you love me. I'm going to love you anyway. And that's sweet. And then in the New Testament, Jesus shows up. He says, listen, I'm God in the flesh, and I'm not just going to tell you I love you. I'm going to show you. So what he did on the cross was he died. And on the cross, he took our sins that we're guilty of, not him. He took our sins on himself on the cross. Is that wild? He said, this is love. You want to know what love is? This is love. This right here is love. And we crucified him, and he died to pay the penalty for our sin. And on the third day, he was resurrected, and that's why we get jacked up about church. So that's why even when 50% of the people that attend this church, 50% of the people that attend this church, 36% have never been to any church of any kind, period. Another 14% say, I haven't been to church in the last 10, 15 years. And that's why when people are drawn in here, you know what? I want to experience something that's real. And we can just show you. This is what it's like to serve the God that we serve. So maybe you're not a follower of Jesus, and you're thinking right now, that dude would shut up and tell me how. So that's what I'm going to do. If you're not a follower of Jesus, but you'd like to be, every head is bowed and every eye is closed. If you're not a follower of Jesus, but you'd like to be, then maybe you just pray a prayer, something like this. You'd say, God, I know I've miserably failed. I have miserably failed you. I confess that. I admit it. And I know that the truth of it is, I'm probably not going to be any better tomorrow. I'm going to still mess up. But I heard this morning that you love me. That you love me. It's not contractual. It's not based on whether I love you back. It's just you love me. It's based on a covenant. You love me. So thank you for your love. Thank you. So I just accept it. And thank you, Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross to pay the penalty for my sin. I'm grateful and I'm thankful. And I know you're alive. I can feel you, your presence with me right now. And to the best of my ability, I want to follow you for the rest of my life. Lord, you are amazing. And we get to do at this church what we get to do. Lord, our prayer is simple. God, use us. Help us to get better at reflecting your love to a world that's desperate to hear it. Help us, Lord, to think of how we can build bridges between the church and people that the church has ostracized and pushed away. Help us, Lord, to be faithful to love the way that you love, the way that you love us. God, do something in this church that is bigger than us just making a better, faster, sweeter version of us. God, I pray that as a church, you'll use us, that the world, the community that we live in, will be a better place because we're here. Thank you that we have the wonderful opportunity of being in a relationship with a God like you. And it's in your sweet name that we pray. Amen. Hey, if you accepted Christ today, if you fill out a card, get us that information. We'll be at your house this afternoon. We won't. I'm just kidding. unless you want to feed us, and then we could leave now if you want to do that. If you just fill out a card, just following Jesus stuff, you don't want to do that by yourself. You weren't intended to do it by yourself. You were intended to do that in community with a few other people. And we'd love to just talk to you about that, what that could look like for you. We can't make you do it. We're not trying to force you to do it. We're just trying to educate you a little bit to what this life of Jesus really looks like. So that would be sweet for us. If you'd like to just talk, hang out, and chat with some folks, I'm here. There's some other folks that'll be down front this morning as well. And we'd love just to hang out and chat with you. Maybe some of you can tell me all this about this Nehemiah stuff that I don't have figured out yet. Hey, I love you. You don't want to miss next week. We got two incredible weeks coming, and then we're gonna start this 21-day fast. It's gonna be awesome. We're all gonna lose tons of weight. Actually, please, you don't want to miss this series when we talk about this fasting thing, because it's not gonna be about. I want to shift your focus if I can. It's not gonna be about that at all. I'm just telling you these next. I will tell you what's coming after that, but I don't know yet. Bye. Love you.